Amen. All right, check it out. Here he was. He was just a humble, godly king in the midst of a long line of wicked kings. And so when this man's kingdom was threatened by this huge, massive army, he didn't turn to the idols of demons like his predecessors. No way, Tom. He turned to God, right? And his enemy approached the city walls and immediately began to taunt the people with fear, saying stuff like this. Tell your king this. On what are you basing this confidence of yours? You say you have strategy and military strength, but you speak only empty words. On whom are you depending that you rebel against me? You will have to eat your own filth and drink your own urine. And then he went on to say stuff like this. He says, and if you say to me, we're depending on the Lord our God, don't be deceived. He can't deliver you. Has the God of any nation ever delivered his hand from mine? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Samaria? Have they rescued them from my hand? Who of all the gods of these countries have been able to save his land from me? And then how then can the Lord deliver you from my hand? Well, the humble king simply replied to his people, don't answer him. And he simply tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, went into the temple of the Lord and prayed for deliverance. And sure enough, the king's God answered him. That very night, an angel of the Lord went out and put to death 185,000 men in the enemy's camp just like that. And when the people got up the next morning, all they saw were dead bodies everywhere. So the rebel enemy withdrew, went back to his own kingdom, whereupon shortly after returning, he was struck down and killed by his own sons while he was busy worshiping his false deity. The book is 2 Kings, a little bit, I believe, in Isaiah as well. The judgment, of course, is the angel slaughter of the Assyrian army with King Sennacherib. How many guys going to name your next cat that? Whatever. Your neighbors might get annoyed by it. What's he saying? No. Anyway, but anyway, folks, this is in the Bible. Did you know that? This really did happen. This isn't make-believe. This is not some nifty flannel graph thing that used to be back in the day or some cartoon thing to draw on for kids to freak them out. Okay, this really happened. And what it tells you and I, is that God, obviously, how many guys would say, is not a very big fan of people blaspheming his name or threatening his people or mocking him, right? It's called sin. And the point is this, passage tells us, folks, God takes sin seriously, even the sin of blasphemy. Okay, God is a God who will judge sin. And once again, here's the point. You would think then that people would stand up and take note and say, hey, woo, wow, okay, I better get right with God now so I don't suffer the coming future judgment of God, right? Unfortunately, that's not what's taking place today. Why? Evolution. That's right, Debbie, I saw that almost coming out of your mouth. Evolution, the lie of evolution is blinding the minds of those who don't believe. And so they not only have a hard time believing in God, but one thing our world absolutely refuses to believe in, and that is that God is a God who will judge and judge sin, right? But he will, okay? And he's going to do it again. And so in order to help these people hopefully become smarter people with all due respect, we're going to continue our study, The Witness of Creation. And what we're doing is taking a look at different evidences that God's left behind for us, showing us, hey, listen, folks, he is not just real, but we really can have an intimate, beautiful, personal relationship with who? God.
Gee, that's exciting.
With who? God. It's amazing, folks, through Jesus Christ. Before it's too late is the whole key phrase there. Okay, and so far we saw that first evidence, he reveals this amazing truth, is through an intelligent creation or intelligent design. The second evidence was the evidence of a young creation or young earth. We have not been here for millions and billions of years. The third evidence was the evidence of a special creation. Unlike the lie of evolution, we were not created by chance with no purpose. We were created for a special purpose, to have a special relationship with a special God. Isn't that wonderful news, okay? And then the last 10 times we saw the fourth evidence was the evidence of a judge creation. And what we saw is, and what we've been seeing is the evidence of a worldwide flood. What's the importance of the worldwide flood?
It shows that there was this guy and his family, and they were the ultimate survivors on a boat. Yeah.
No, it's not just that. It's why. What was the flood about? God judged sin. He judged the whole planet because of sin, and he's going to do it again. And we've been taking a look at that literal account, okay? Not just because the Bible says so. We've been taking a look at the evidence. And last time, if you were here, we saw the evidence of giant life forms. You know, my family heritage. Insert chuckle. Thank you, all three of you. All right, okay, and what we've been seeing is evidences of giant ages, giant conditions that produce these giant things, including giant plants, as we saw last time. And we saw, listen, there is no need to cave into the lie of evolution. And as a Christian, you don't need to somehow try to squeeze evolution and the biblical account together. Just leave it alone. Leave the scripture alone. Just do your homework, okay, and you're going to see it all makes perfect sense. God doesn't lie, okay? There really is justification for giant ages, giant conditions, and even giant plants, okay? But that's not all. The fourth evidence, we're going to see that there really was giant life forms. The Genesis account is literal, okay? Is we also find not just giant ages, giant conditions, giant plants. We find, that's right, giant people. What? Are you serious? Yes, giant people. But don't take my word for it. The Bible's very clear about this. Open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. And we're going to read the first 8 verses there. And you find the copyright symbol. What do you do? Hang on. Right. Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Let's take a look. Giants. Were there really giants? I mean, really? I thought it was just fairy tale stuff. Well, once again, folks, there's a lot more going on in history than meets the eye. Okay, let's take a look at what the scripture has to say. Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. When you get there, say moo. Moo. Music to my ears. When men began to increase in number on the earth and daughters were born to them, the sons of God, angels, i.e. fallen angels, as we'll see here, saw that the daughters of men were beautiful and they married any of them they chose. Then the Lord said, that's it. My spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal, and the days will be 120 years. Clock's a ticking. Flood's going to come. He's had it. You just crossed the line, so to speak, okay? Then it says this. The who? The Nephilim were on the earth in those days. Now listen to this key phrase there. And also what? Afterward. Okay, when the sons of God, angels, went to the daughters of men and had children by them. They were the heroes of old, men of renown. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. And so the Lord was grieved that he made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. So the Lord said, I will wipe mankind whom I created from the face of the earth, men and animals and creatures that move along the ground, the birds of the air, for I am grieved that I have made them. But what? Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Anybody glad that you found favor in the eyes of the Lord? Through Jesus Christ, okay? We're not going to be judged, okay? But according to the Bible, we see that before, what's going on here? Before the world was judged by a flood, literally, there apparently was a group of people called out by name and category, if you will, in the Bible, who were called the Nephilim, okay? Is what the word says there. And so, obviously, the question is, well, who in the world are the Nephilim? Those people that lived past Henderson? No. Okay, the word Nephilim in the Hebrew literally means giant. That's why some of you have been saying that, okay? It means giant, and the phrase is there, heroes of old, literally means mighty strong ones. So you put the biblical text together, and what you have is this. The Bible pictures a group of people who were giant, big people, big, strong, mighty people, and apparently they were well-known in Noah's day, okay? And again, some would say that these giant beings, these big, mighty heroes of old, big things going on there, okay, were created by some sort of hybrid issue going on with the fallen angels, okay? And I think that is one part of what created some of the giants and things of that nature prior to the flood, okay? But others would say, no, really what's going on there that produced these Nephilim was what we saw last week and the pre-flood atmosphere and conditions that produced giantism and everything. And they say, well, it's just that because it's too freaky to deal with this angel fallen angel demon thing. I personally don't think it's a either or. I think it's a both and. I think sons of God are clearly sons of God, that they're angels, as freaky as that sounds, okay? And maybe someday we can get into that in greater detail, okay? And I think that's some of the issues that's going on with UFOs and aliens and things of that nature that's being repeated today. But I think it's a both and. I think it was, yes, certainly the sons of God, the angels, creating some sort of hybrid, the Nephilim, but also because, like we saw last week, everything got bigger before the flood, not just plants, but as we're going to see, even people, okay? And that's why I think is key to understand, because notice what that text says. It says the Nephilim were not only on the earth before, they were also after the flood, right? And so that means if you and I tonight are going to take this Genesis account literally, which we should, by the way, okay, then we need to find some evidence that there are these big, huge, mighty, strong people, not just before Noah's day, but after Noah's day. And guess what we find? That's exactly what we find. And we're going to see all kinds of evidence, folks. You talk about an ultimate conspiracy. This is awesome. Okay, the first evidence that there really was giant people, not only before the flood, but afterwards, after the flood, like the Bible says, is the evidence of mythology. Okay, now stop and think about this. This is really kind of cool, okay? Maybe there's more going on to those mythological characters, okay, that we've been led to believe, okay? It just so happens, folks, I mean, think about this. We've talked about this before. Just like with the account of the flood itself, it's the same thing with the giants, right? You know, we've talked before that, well, gee whiz, if there really was a worldwide flood and it was a global event, that you would think that some other culture would record it somewhere in the writing, somewhere outside the Bible, if it was really that huge global of event, right? And affected all of humanity. Well, what have we seen before? There's lots of them, nearly 500 accounts, okay, of cultures around the world giving various accounts of a worldwide flood, and that's what you'd expect. The point here tonight is, it's the same thing with these giants. When you do the history, it's not just virtually every culture talks about the flood, it's the same thing when it comes to these giant creatures, and you see that in mythology, okay? Let's take a look at some of that evidence. First of all, the word giant was coined in 1297, comes from the English word that was used for monsters of human appearance and great massive size and strength. And these accounts of giant men are common throughout mythology and legends of various cultures around the planet. Okay, let's take a look at some of those. In Greece, that's one of the most popular ones, right? The Greeks believed that the giants, or the gigantes, as they were called, were involved in a conflict. This was their demise with the Olympian gods, and they called that conflict the gigantomachy, or the struggle between the gods and the giants. Okay, these giants, they believe, lost the battle and were placed beneath the earth where they continue to make mischief, causing volcanoes and earthquakes today, as they would say. Okay, Plutarch describes how the Athenians covered the body of a giant called Theseus, who was, quote, more of ordinary size. And another ancient writer, Pausanias, wrote how the kneecaps of another giant named Ajax, you know where Ajax, the cleaner, that's where you get it from, okay, that his kneecaps were the size of a discus, you know, the guy that throws that thing, his kneecaps were that size, for the pentathlon, suggesting he may have been around 14 feet tall. In fact, the Jewish historian Josephus wrote about how there may be much more truth to the Greek accounts of giants than legend. We call them myths, mythology, make-believe stories. Jewish historian, this is a contemporary of the time of Jesus Christ's first coming, he says, no, there's a lot more truth going on. As years have progressed, people say, oh, that's a bunch of baloney. And they just call it mythology. He said, no, I don't think so. Quote, this is from his writings. For many angels of God accompanied with women and begat sons that proved unjust and despisers of all that was good on account of the confidence they had in their own strength. Okay? For the tradition is that these men did what resembled the acts of those whom the Grecians called giants. So he's saying, listen, there's a lot more going on. What the Greeks called the giants might be a little bit, you know, perverted in some areas, but the core element is there was really giants in those days in the pre-flood world. William Winston, he's the translator of Josephus' writings, he said, quote, this notion that the fallen angels were, in some sense, the fathers of the old giants was the constant opinion of what? Antiquity. So you go back in history, it's only until recent times that people say, oh no, that's all make-believe. Okay? And of course, evolution has helped to provide that kind of unfortunate attitude. Well, let's take a look. That's not just the Greeks. It's all over the world. How about in the Norse mythology? They speak of the Jotun, or the giants, and some were not only portrayed as being huge, as you can see there, depicted, but they categorize them. There was different kinds of giants, frost giants, fire giants, mountain giants. They gave them names like Loki, Mimir, Agur, etc. And it was believed that their chief god, Odin, was the great-grandson of the first giant called Ymir. Okay? And is what they believe, but also in Hinduism. It's all over the world. Just like the flood is recorded in all cultures on the planet, it's the same thing with giants. In Hinduism, they call them the Daityas, and they were considered to be the children of Diti. Okay? Always made up these jingles, these songs, little Diddy Ryan, you get it? You got it? Thank you, whatever. Hey, you try to make that funny, whatever. Diddy, who fought against the gods or the divas, and because they were jealous of these diva half-brothers and were said to be a power-seeking race. So they have records of that. Also in Bulgaria, this is interesting, in Bulgarian mythology, the giants are called Ispalini and are believed to inhabit the earth before modern humans and lived in mountains, fed on raw meat, and often fought against the dragons. Ooh-wee. Wait, Lord willing, in a couple weeks when we get to the final section, the truth about dinosaurs, And did you know that if there were some dinosaurs, wait a second. If the Bible says that God created all the land animals on day six, right, and Noah took land animals on the ark, then that means the dinosaurs must have also been, according to the Bible, created on day six, and then Noah must have taken some of them on the ark. What? And then if he took some of them on the ark, then maybe some of them survived afterwards. A few of them anyway, maybe. What? Well, why don't you ever see? Well, maybe you do. You see, the word dinosaur is a recent word. Okay, back in the day when they saw these creatures going around, these huge creatures, they didn't have the word dinosaur to call them. The word they used to call them was dragons. And you see, not only giants, but dragons. Ooh, wait till we get to that in a couple weeks, Lord willing. Lots of stuff going on there. But that's what they believe, okay? In Europe, okay, in other European mythology and folklore, it said that King Arthur faced a giant and that many of the giants were believed, listen, to have built the remains of previous civilizations, okay? And this guy, Saxo Grammaticus, for example, he argues that the giants had to exist, okay, because nothing else would explain the large walls, the stone monuments, and the statues that were in existence, as this guy shares. Maybe it isn't just that they had the technology that we saw before that they had that we can't even duplicate. Maybe they were able to do this stuff because they were bigger. Let's take a look at that.
In Lebanon, 44 miles from Beirut, are the imposing ruins of Baalbek. There is mention of this place in the Old Testament's Book of Kings.
Baalbek in particular is a very good example. That has the trilithon. Those are the largest stones in the world ever used for construction. They're so large we don't even know their actual weight. Those stones were somehow quarried, moved 5 miles, lifted 25, 30 feet in the air, and placed together so closely that you can't fit a razor blade or a piece of paper in between them. We have no idea how they did it. We don't have a crane in the world that can lift weights anywhere near what those things are.
No one knows for sure, but according to Arab tradition, the earliest temples were built here after the great flood by a tribe of giants for the biblical king Nimrod.
Interesting. So maybe it was a combination of technology and size to be able to pull off some of this stuff. Let's keep going. In fact, the tales of combat with giants were common in folklore throughout Europe, in Wales, Scotland, Ireland. Many giants in English folklore told how giants threw stones at each other. Okay, and this is why, and is used to explain how many great stones appeared on the landscape. How did they build Stonehenge anyway? Who did that? How did they lift that stuff up? Interesting. And many today's fairy tales like Jack the Giant Killer have now formed our modern perception of giants as stupid, violent monsters, sometimes said to eat humans, especially children. So, you know, they kind of make fun of them. But maybe there's a little bit more truth to them. In fact, in the Americas, there's all kinds of stories of giants. Okay, I'll just give you a little bit here. The Native American mythologies record how there were many giants throughout different parts of here in North America. In fact, according to the Paiute Indians, a race of red-haired giants that they called the Satika were cannibals. Oh, so maybe there's a little bit more truth to that, about eating kids or whatever, and lived between, listen, the Sierra Nevada and the Rocky Mountains. And their mummified remains have allegedly been discovered in a cave near Lovelock, Nevada. Wow. Anybody want to take a road trip this Saturday? Interesting. Oh, lots of stuff going on in the desert, I tell you. But you start putting all this together, folks. We could spend a whole night just on mythology and the history of giants around the world. I just want to give you a little teaser. It's the exact same thing that's going on with the flood. You would think if there really was a worldwide flood, right, then you'd have other cultures talking about it outside the Bible. We do, over 500. You would think if there really were these things called giants, Nephilim, whatever, you know, that said was there before and after, you'd think somebody else would be talking. They are. It's the exact same thing, okay? There really was giants before and giants after, exactly like the Genesis account says. The second evidence that there really was giant people, not only before but after the flood, is the evidence of Scripture, okay? And hopefully, logically, you're going down this train of thought, okay? Because you might be thinking, like Ryan tonight, right, Ryan? Yeah, Ryan, you get that first piece of gum, buddy. What a guy. He even cut it. Man, your grandma didn't even bat an eye. You didn't even blink. You didn't even move, man. You're like a warrior. So anyway, I'll tell you what. I want you in a battle with me. But anyway, Scripture, I digress. Scripture, because you might be thinking, okay, Pastor Billy, so the cultures around the planet talk about giants, after the flood, okay, just like the flood itself. I get that, so that's kind of interesting, okay? But how do we know that these people, like the Norsemen, the Greeks, and all that, how do we know that their accounts are accurate like the Bible, okay? I mean, can we really trust those accounts? I mean, shouldn't we as Christians, shouldn't we stick to something much more reliable like the Bible itself? Yeah, absolutely. I hope you're asking that question. Our sole authority for truth is the Bible. So let's see what the Bible says about these giants. We read the Genesis account before the flood. But folks, you read the Bible talks about giants after the flood in various places, okay? And I want to share that with you. Now, we all know the account of Goliath, so I'm not going to belabor that one, a giant in the Bible. But I want to give you some other ones. And the first passage that mentions giants in the Bible after the flood is Deuteronomy chapter 3. And this deals with Og of Bashan, okay? Let's take a look at this passage here. Deuteronomy 3, verse 10 through 11, okay? You know, this is usually where we get into trouble. You know, every year, you know, make that New Year's resolution. I'm gonna read through the Bible this year. If it's the last thing I do, I'm going to do it. And you usually start off pretty good, and you go through Genesis, and there's lots of action going on. It's great. And you keep on cruising through Exodus, and there's more action going on. And by the time you get here, it's like, and you quit. Yeah, you know it's true. Preacher's going meddling. Already, Tom. Don't speed through this. There's all kinds of stuff going on. God put it there for a reason. Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 10 through 11. We took all the towns on the plateau and all Gilead and all Bashan as far as Salika and Edrei, towns of Og's kingdom in Bashan. Only Og, king of Bashan, was left of the remnant of the Rephaites. His bed, listen, this is in one verse. And how many times we flipped right by this baby? His bed was made of iron and was more than what? 13 feet long and what? 6 feet wide. In fact, they said, it's still in Rabbah of the Ammonites. In other words, Tom, you want to go check it out? Just go on over there. Probably not today. That was back then when it was written. Okay. But how many guys would say, it's right there in the Bible, this is after the flood, that a 13-foot long bed, 6 feet wide, made of iron. Why would you make it of iron? A big guy, right? Need the extra support. But how many guys, that's a pretty big dude. Okay, obviously, okay. And but this guy would make this Og of Bashan a giant, a massive guy, a giant of a guy after the flood, okay? In fact, if you do the math, and if you use the Egyptian cubit, you're going to see that maybe he was bigger than 13 feet, okay? And if he continues to do the math, try feeding one of these guys. You're going to hope this guy never showed up for Thanksgiving. Watch this. This is wild.
The Egyptian royal cubit was 20.63 inches. And with that in mind, we can now put it into our own calculations, which would make his bed 15 feet 6 inches, and its width 6 feet 10 inches. So, and of course it was made of iron. It's not just some guy with a big ego. But because it was made of iron, it means that he was very heavy. And so he's probably a little bit shorter. He's probably about 15 feet tall. And when we begin to look at that, here's modern man, and there's Goliath, and we have the Irish giant of 12 feet, and then King Og, who's 15 feet. Putting them next to each other, you can see how you'd be somewhat intimidated next to this guy. And according to God, the Amorites were even taller. So, remember, King Og is just of the remnant of the Rephaim. He's not even the big guy. So, watch out. And how heavy was he? Well, thanks to Galileo and his equation he came up with, we can calculate his weight. So he was about 3,125 pounds. And he, you know, probably could lift his own body weight, I'm sure, maybe double that. So he could probably lift at least two horses at the same time with a rider and throw them. Probably a mid-sized car of today. You'd want to watch out if this guy's in your path. And they said it was a land that devours its inhabitants because everybody was of great stature. Well, we can also calculate his basal metabolic rate. That means just the amount of calories needed to keep his heart beating, to stay alive, just the basics. He needed at least 22,657 calories every day just to stay alive. That's not even talking about normal activity. You can only guess what he would have needed for normal activity. That's just his very basic is equal to 9 normal-sized persons. We convert that into pizzas. You've got 12-inch pizzas or 63 cheeseburgers and probably a lamb every 2 days. So, if he was really working out and stuff and going to war, He may have needed, a lamb every day, or maybe two lambs a day. It was a land that devoured its inhabitants.
Now, Jeanette, I know exactly what you're thinking. You are sweating bullets hoping that Og of Bashan never visits here and fills out one of those Connect cards. Because you know that week, I'd have to rent a U-Haul to deliver the cookies for him. You know what I'm saying? Whoa, what? Absolutely wild, okay? How many guys would cry if that guy came over for Thanksgiving? Or for even a snack? Okay, watch your dog. Okay, but anyway, no wonder the Israelites, now think about this. Why are they always recording this stuff in the Old Testament? They record these battles, right? Did they record every battle or are they just hitting the, I think they're, maybe they're even hitting the highlights. No wonder they record this guy. And no wonder they record that phrase there about his bed. Okay, I think this is a guy thing. I mean, this is like, yeah, we took down Og of Bashan, the big guy, the giant, right? And I think that's what's going on. The Bible even it records this as big news. Also, when they took down the Anakites, the Edomites, the Amorites, and the Rephaites, if you do this genealogy study, all these guys were of lineage of the giants. So no wonder the Bible repeatedly writes down, we took these guys down and these guys down. Could you imagine fighting that guy? And if you actually won, you guys would record it somewhere. Yeah, I took down this guy, right? Isn't that interesting, okay? The second passage that mentions giants after the flood is Numbers 13. How many times have we read through this and just skipped right over it and had no clue as to why these guys were so afraid, okay? Let's take a look at what's going on. This is the 12 spies, by the way. Numbers 13, 26 to 33. They came back to Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelite community at Kadesh in the desert of Paran. There they reported to them the whole assembly and showed them the fruit of the land. Remember those giant grapes? The grapes were so huge they had to have a pole to carry them, two guys. Big food for big people. Okay? They gave Moses this account. We went into the land which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Yeah, God was right, right? Here's the fruit. See the size of these grapes? Whoa. But the people who live there are powerful, they said, and the cities are fortified and very large. And we even saw the descendants of Anak there, and the Amalekites, they live in the Negev, and the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites. Remember the genealogy of the giants. Live in the hill country, and the Canaanites live near the sea and along the Jordan. And then Caleb said, hey, in the Hebrew, shut your mouth. He silenced the people before Moses and said, hey, listen, we should go up and take possession of the land. We can certainly do it. God's got our back. What are you freaking out for? But no, the men who had gone up with them said, no, we can't attack those people. They're stronger than we are. And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. They said, the land we explored devours the people living in it. The people we saw are of great size. We saw the Nephilim there, the descendants of Anak come from the Nephilim. We seem like what? Grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we look the same to them. How many times did we read that, not realizing what they were really saying? Okay? This is the infamous account of the 12 spies that came back from spying out the land. They finally made it there. They didn't get lost in the desert. They made it there, just like God said, here's the promised land. I want you to give it. And what did they do? They came back with a report. Okay? At least 10 of the 12, two of them, Caleb and Joshua, trusted God, believed God, but 10 out of the 12 came back and they said, yeah, the land is flowing with milk and honey. God, you're right. This is a phenomenal place you're giving us. Okay, this is great. But what was their problem? They were freaking out because there were giants there. There were Nephilim there. Okay, now what's interesting is if you don't get that, okay, they even makes this amazing statement. And I think sometimes we want to write it off as a euphemism. Right? Or they're using hyperbole. They're exaggerating to make a point. And they said the phrase there, we are the size of grasshoppers compared to these guys. Well, maybe the reason why they said they were the size of grasshoppers compared to these guys is because that's really what was going on. These people were huge, like what this guy shares. Let's take a look.
And there we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, who come of the Nephilim. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. It's pretty easy to see why they would have viewed themselves that way. I mean, think about it. That big guy there would have looked at the 6-footer, little grasshopper, I squash you like a bug. And the other guy like, man, I feel like a grasshopper compared to that guy, right? Well, when you look through Scripture, you find that sometimes it seems that the writers just insert something that doesn't appear to have anything really to do with anything. I mean, it's interesting, whatever, but so what? Like the grapes. When you're reading in Numbers 13, remember the story about the grapes? Man, it took two guys to carry a cluster of grapes on a pole. So what? I mean, it's just they got big grapes there. Wow. Well, as I'm studying the giants and looking at all this stuff and thinking about height and all this, my wife had actually brought me a bowl of grapes, and I actually had a full cluster of grapes in the bowl. So I'm already studying all this. I look at this cluster of grapes, I grab it, and I walk into the bathroom, and I hold it up to my head just to get a scale. I wanted to get a scale. I'm like, why, you know, this is cool. Why'd you put it in here? You know, big deal. So I held up a cluster of grapes to my head just to get a scale to how big does a cluster of grapes look to a person's head. And then I began to think, how big would this cluster of grapes have to get before I couldn't carry it anymore by myself? You know, I'm fairly strong. I'm 170 pounds. I'm thinking, okay. I started to scale up a giant with a cluster of grapes just to see how big it would have to get before I would need help. Well, I kept doing it, and I found that it'd have to be over a 30-footer before the cluster of grapes would be scaled such that it'd be so big that I would need to ask my buddy for help carrying the thing. So I found that the cluster of grapes actually helps you understand the scale of the giants, interestingly enough. Wow! And I found this quote from an individual by the name of Michael Aloof, page 41 of his book, History of Baalbek. He says, after the flood, when Nimrod reigned over Lebanon, he sent giants to rebuild the fortress of Baalbek, which was so named in honor of Baal, the god of the Moabites, and worshippers of the sun. See that stone right there? That thing's huge. You can see the size comparison with the guy that's standing there. That's roughly a 6-foot-tall man standing on the end of that stone right there. Now, modern historians and archaeologists will look at that and scratch their head and go, we don't have any clue. How in the world did somebody quarry that rock? How did they carve that rock? How did they move that rock? Nobody can understand that when you're trying to look at it with that frame of mind. 6-foot-tall guy. Looking at our resources today, we couldn't move something that big. But if we let the Scriptures speak for us, I believe this solves the problem. And there's what you got. You imagine two guys like Arnold, strong as the oaks, right? Now that's pretty easy to see how that rock was moved. Hey, Arnold, stop flexing. Get over here and give me a hand. Stop showing off for the camera. I need some help here. That totally explains the megalithic structures all around the world. Let the Scripture speak for itself. It tells you there were giants in the earth in those days. And also after that. That being before the flood, yes, and also after the flood as well.
Interesting. I'm so sorry to bore you guys tonight with this boring Bible study. The Bible is such a... Isn't it absolutely amazing? The Bible is such a fascinating book if you take the time to get in there to go. But no wonder you start doing these size comparisons. I don't know if I'm into the 30-foot tall perspective, me personally. But again, maybe that's my own disbelief. I don't know. But still, you look at the size comparison, no wonder. Maybe that's a loaded statement. Maybe when the Israelites said, we look like grasshoppers, they really look like grasshoppers compared to these guys. Remember, there's a lot more truth going on, okay? The third passage, and this leads us to this one, the third passage that mentions the giants after the flood is Amos chapter 2, and this is God's rebuke of the Israelites, okay? Let's take a look at what God has to say there. Amos chapter 2, verse 9 through 10, God speaking, he says, I destroyed the Amorites, you know, the giants. What are you freaking out for? I destroyed them before them. Though he was, listen, God says, as tall as the what? Cedars. What's that? That's a tree. He's as tall as a tree, as God says. And strong as the oaks. I destroyed his fruit above and his roots below. I brought you out of Egypt. I led you for 40 years in the desert to give you to the land of the Amorites. Okay? So you see here, God didn't get mad, if you will, okay, and judge the Israelites because they were lying about the giants. Because they weren't. Okay, there really were giants, and they really did look like grasshoppers. That's not what they got in trouble for. According to the Scripture, their problem was a lack of trust in God, unbelief in him, that he could take care of the giants. And he's rebuking them here. I took care of what are you guys freaking out for? Okay, they should have trusted God. They didn't need to run and flee. Okay, they should have trusted God to take care of them. But I wanted to give you a little bit of perspective with some modern technology. I'm not justifying the Israelites' unbelief, because that is sin. Because we don't do that with God, do we? We don't act like our problems are too giant for him to... Yeah, he's going to meddling part two, Tom. Okay, but I wanted to give you an idea of maybe why they came back with such great fear. Maybe they were afraid the battle was going to end up something like this once they entered the promised land. Let's take a look.
Giant!
The monks haven't rung that bell in... You know, I don't think I've ever heard them ring it.
Run!
Jack? Jack!
What's he yelling?
Giant!
Kind of makes the scripture come alive, doesn't it? That scene when they're running away? That's the wrong day to have a Shetland pony. How many guys would say that guys the size of trees, what the passage in Amos say? Cedar tree. The guys the size of trees throwing trees would kind of freak you out. I'm not here to justify the Israelites' behavior. Okay, but you got something going on here. They got rebuked by God, not because they were lying about giants and that they were grasshoppers in comparison. They got rebuked by God because they didn't trust him to take care of those giants, as big as that is. You're getting an idea of, whoa. But are you also getting the bravery and the trust that Caleb and Joshua had? Says, no, we can do it with God. The lesson for you and I is this. We got giant problems today, but don't ever think that God can't take care of them, that they're too big for him. God is a giant killer, and we need to trust him, and he will slay them one by one and lead us into the promised land. Now, if you can't make that preach, you ain't got no preach in you. Okay, but anyway, the third evidence we're going to see that there really was giant people not only before, but after the flood, is the evidence of history. Okay, and you might be thinking, okay, Pastor Billy, so mythology and the Bible talk about giants before and after the flood. I get that. But what about recent history? You would think that there's a lot more element of truth than we're led to believe about these giants. Then again, it would be recorded throughout history, here and there. Well, guess what? It is all over the place. Once again, let me give you a little bit of that information. Giants throughout history. The body of Orestes, according to the Greeks, was 11 and a half feet long. Pliny describes this guy, Gabarus, who was brought to Rome by Claudius Caesar from Arabia. He was 9 to 10 feet in height. Adds that the remains of Posio and Secundula found in the reign of Augustus Caesar in this garden place, which was supposed to be the guardians, measured 10 feet, 3 inches each. Josephus tells this guy, Eliezer, who was sent to the king of Persia to Rome, was nearly 11 feet tall. There's stories of Emperor Maximilian that he was between 8.5 to 9 feet tall, and that he used his wife's bracelet for a finger ring, and that he ate 40 pounds of flesh a day and drank 6 gallons of wine. He was also credited with being a great runner, and in his earlier days is said to have conquered single-handedly 8 soldiers. If you can go back to that video with the giants depicted from Hollywood, if you will. Wow. Maybe, again, there's a lot more truth going on, folks. It really makes the Bible come alive. Saxo the Grammarian, once again, he mentions a giant 13.5 feet tall in his writings. Ferragus, this is a monster, quote-unquote, supposed to have been slain by this guy Roland, the nephew of Charlemagne, was supposed to be 11 feet high, about. It was said that there was a giant living in the 12th century under the rule of King Eugene of Scotland, 11.5 feet tall. Becanus, a physician of Charles V, says he saw a youth, listen, a youth, 9 feet tall, youth, and a man and a woman almost 10 feet tall. Keisler mentions this guy Hansbrow in Tyrol in 1550. He was nearly 12 feet tall. Ainsworth said in 1553, the Tower of London was guarded by 3 brothers, claiming direct descendant from Henry VIII and surnamed Og, Gog, and Magog. All were over 8 feet tall, guarding the tower. In his Chronicles of Holland, 1557, this guy said that at the time of John, Earl of Holland, a giant Nicholas was so large that men could stand under his arms and his shoe held 3 ordinary feet. Okay? This guy, Platter, speaks of a girl in Switzerland, 5 years old, whose body was large as that of a full-grown woman at the age of 5, and who weighed, was a year old, was as much as a bushel of wheat. I wonder if the mom survived the birth. You know that you're going that, I was going that direction. He also mentions a man living 9 feet, he was 9 feet tall, whose hand was 1.5 feet long. The hand. Okay, 1712 in Holland, there died a fisherman named this guy, Garrett, whatever. He was 8 feet tall, weighed 500 pounds. John Middleton, born in 1752 in Lancashire, humorously called the Child of Hale. He measured 9 feet, 3 inches tall. Patrick Cotter, a successor of this guy, claimed that he was a descendant of the famous Irish king, Brian Boru, declared that he was 9 feet in height, died in 1806 at the age of 45. His shoe was 17 inches long, and he was 8 feet, 4 inches tall at his death. And as you guys know, when you get older, you kind of shrink a little bit. So obviously you can tell I am 197 years old. Let's move on. The annual register records the death of Peter Tuchin from Posen, 1825. He was 29 years old, 8 feet 7 inches in height. There's a giant in St. Peter's in June 1829, 8 feet 8 inches tall, who was thin and emaciated, probably ate chicken, messed him up. Dr. Adam Clark, you know I had to get that in there. He died in 1832. He was 8 feet 6 inches tall. 1837 in Parma, there was a young man in the service of the King of the Netherlands, 8 feet 10 inches high, weighed 401 pounds. Fraser speaks of Chilean giants, 9 feet tall. Buffalo Bill, he mentions encountering giants in his travels in America, and he writes some interesting things in his diary. We finally made it to the teaser. Let's take a look at that.
Now, if you study ancient legends, you'll discover the ancient, most earliest culture, Sumer, has these legends, Assyria, Egypt, Incas, Mayan, Gilgamesh in Babylon, Persia, Greece, of course. Most of us are familiar with the Greek versions of this mythology. India, Bolivia, South Asia, even the American Indians. I came across a fascinating reference in a book that was considered at the time very reliable, the autobiography of William Cody, commonly known as Buffalo Bill. And if you look at Buffalo Bill's autobiography, Colonel William F. Cody in 1920, there's a paragraph, I put part of it in here. He says, while we were in the sand hills scouting the Niobrara country, the Pawnee Indians brought into camp some very large bones, one of which the surgeon of the expedition pronounced to be the thigh bone of a human being. The Indians said the bones were those of a race of people who long ago had lived in that country. They said these people were 3 times the size of a man of the present day, and they were so swift and strong that they could run by the side of a buffalo and, taking the animal in one arm, could tear off a leg and eat it as they ran. The bone was too big. They didn't have wagons, so they didn't keep it. So he recorded it in his journal. So don't know what to make of that, but I think it's interesting. You'll discover, if you study Indian lore, that the Indians were terrified of the six-fingered people. That's why when they met a stranger, they held up the hand to prove they only had five fingers. This how business is Hollywood, but the idea of greeting a stranger with your hand so he could count fingers. You'll find that recorded in the pictoglyphs in Chaca, New Mexico, among other places.
Well, that's interesting. Let's just get it over with. How are you guys doing? We'll talk later, Brian. But now, folks, what's interesting, I mean, just like, wow, talk about the Bible coming alive. That how thing of the Indians, just a little thing mentioned there, okay, fits in perfectly, shocker, with what the Bible mentions about these giants. They also had a tendency to have more digits, according to the Bible. And this is what you read. And once again, those books you shouldn't read so fast. Take your time. First Chronicles chapter 20, verse 4 through 8. And four, in the course of time, war broke out with the Philistines at Gezer. And at that time, Sibekai the Hushathite killed Sipai, one of the descendants of who? Raphites. We're talking about giants again. And the Philistines were subjugated. In another battle with the Philistines, Elhanan, son of Jair, killed Lami, the brother of Goliath, giant, the Gittite, who had a spear with a shaft like a weaver's rod. In still another battle, which took place at Gath, there was a huge man with what? Six fingers on each hand and six toes on each foot, 24 in all. Maybe there's more to the Indian legend. He also was a descendant of who? Rapha, the giant. When he taunted Israel, Jonathan, son of Shimea, David's brother, killed him. These were the descendants of Rapha and Gath, and they fell at the hands of David and his men. No wonder people bragged on David. That's a whole nother interesting thing. David, everybody else is running with fear. David took on the giants. David, when he took on Goliath, most biblical scholars would say he wasn't a grown man. Some would say he's anywhere from 12 to 14 to 16 years old. Look, my son, grasshopper, taking on a giant. No wonder David's fame. Isn't that wild? Interesting, okay. But that's not all. The fourth evidence, the rule was giant. People know it before, but after the flood, is what I call the evidence of conspiracy. Okay, the evidence of conspiracy. And you might be thinking, well, after all this information on giants, the logical question is, you know, they're mentioned in mythology, they're mentioned in the Bible, they're mentioned in history. You'd think that you'd hear about it somewhere on the news and the media, academia, somewhere, right? Well, yeah, absolutely. That's what you'd think. The problem is there's a conspiracy going on. And Lord willing, Tom, next week, we'll get to that. Oh, let's close in prayer.
Well, hi, this is Pastor Billy Crone of Sunrise Baptist Church and Get a Life Ministries. And I hope you enjoyed today's study. But in closing, before you go, let me ask you one final question. If you were to die today, are you sure that you go to heaven and not hell? You see, here's the problem. The Bible says that nobody automatically gets to go to heaven. And that's because God is holy and we are not. The Bible says that the wages of our sin or our unholiness or the wrong things that we have done have separated us from God. And the wages of our sin or unholiness means that we deserve to die and receive God's judgment to go to hell and not heaven. In other words, we're disqualified for heaven. And that's because God being holy and us being not, the two cannot mix. So what are we going to do? Well, that's bad enough. The other problem is we don't even want to admit this dilemma, even though God already knows it all. And so out of love, God gave us something called the Ten Commandments to show us that we're really disqualified for heaven. We're not holy. We're not perfect like him. Let's take a look at just a few of those here today. The Bible says, the Ten Commandments says, you shall not bear false witness. That means lying. How many of you ever told a lie before? Well, those of you who didn't raise your hand, you just did. Okay, let's be honest, folks. Let's not tell another lie. We've all lied. Well, believe it or not, that disqualifies you for heaven. That's how holy God is. He is the truth. He does not lie. And so that makes us a liar. Another of the Ten Commandments says, you shall not steal. Okay? How many have ever taken anything without permission? Well, all of our hands should have went up at that one. We've already said we're a bunch of liars. Okay? Well, we've all done that. And it doesn't have to be a bank. It could be a pencil in the third grade. That means that we're a thief, okay? The Bible says that God is so holy, even his name is holy, and that's why one of the Ten Commandments says, you shall not use the Lord's name in vain. Hey, folks, isn't it ironic how now the blessed name of Jesus Christ, the Bible says there's no other name under heaven by which men might be saved, Jesus Christ, has now become a cuss word? Folks, the Bible says that's the sin of blasphemy, okay? And folks, let's be honest, we've used God's name in vain before. The Bible also says in the Ten Commandments, you shall not commit adultery. And Jesus takes the standard even higher. He says, listen, it's not just physical adultery. He says, surely I tell you that if you look at another person with lust in your eye, you've committed adultery in your heart. God looks at the heart. One more out of the Ten Commandments says, you shall not murder. And you might say, well, hey, I haven't done that one. Really? The Bible says that the sin of hatred is akin to the sin of murder. You, in other words, in your heart, wish they were dead. You pulled the trigger, if you will, in your own heart. And the Bible says God sees that, and it's just as bad. He knows the mind, he knows the hearts, the thoughts, and the intents that we have. Folks, that's just 5 out of the 10 commandments. How are you doing? Not very well. None of us can keep them. They're God's x-ray to show us that we're disqualified. And so when, not if, your time comes, because we're all marching towards the grave at different speeds, you're going to have to stand before God, and you're going to have to say who you really are. He already knows. Hey, God, let me into heaven. I'm a liar. I'm a thief. I'm a blasphemer, adulterer, and a murderer. Folks, the Bible is clear. Such people as these will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. That's the problem. Here's the good news. God so loved the world that he sent his one and only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in him, what he did on the cross on our behalf, that we will not perish, we will not go to hell, but he will give us the gift of eternal life. Jesus died on the cross to forgive us of all of our sins. It's something that we don't earn. We can't earn. It's a gift, the Bible calls it, and a gift cannot be earned. He was taking the death penalty in our place. That's what the cross was of the day. And that if we would just ask Jesus Christ to forgive us of our sins, and believe that in our heart that God raised him from the grave, showing that his death is satisfactory to God to forgive us of all of our sins, no matter what we've done, the Bible says we shall be saved. The Apostle Paul says that if we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the grave, we will be saved. Let me give you a common analogy of what God's doing and what he did for us with Jesus dying on the cross on our behalf. In life, we know that people can be sentenced for a crime to where they're actually on death row. The courtroom scene has completely finished. The gavel has already sounded. They are going to jail, and they're just awaiting their time before they go to the death penalty. As they're sitting there in the jail cell, it's a proven fact they did what they did. Everybody knows it. They're just waiting for that time for their number to come up, so to speak, and walk down that hall and be executed. There's nothing they could do to reverse their crime. No amount of good works in that jail cell can reverse what they've done. It's too late. It's over. But believe it or not, there's one way that people even today can get off a death row. And that's if the one in authority, the governor, if he were to, out of mercy and kindness, nothing that the person did, because they don't earn it and they don't deserve it and they can't earn it, if he would grant them what's called a pardon, out of the kindness of his heart, he has the authority to grant them a pardon and absolve them completely of their crimes against the state. And did you know that there's actually been people that this has happened to, that the governor, out of mercy, has granted them a pardon as a gift, and they've gone down to the jail cell and handed that person, extended it through the bars, here, I'm granting you a pardon. If you would just receive it, you can go free right now. And did you know that there's actually been people who've said, no, I don't want your pardon. And so what happened is of their own doing, even though they had a way out, they still had to go to the death penalty. Folks, can I tell you something? That's what God did for us with Jesus dying on the cross. He sent his son to take the death penalty in our place. He, God, has the authority to grant us through Jesus a complete pardon. And every day that you're still alive, God is extending to you spiritually this pardon But a pardon does you no good unless you reach out and receive it by faith. Won't you do that today? Won't you call upon the name of Jesus Christ? Ask him to forgive you of all of your sins, to trust in his work on the cross, to pardon us from all of our crimes, our sins against God. God loves you. He wants a relationship with you. But there's only one way to heaven. It's Jesus. There's only one way to get off a death row. It's through the cross of Jesus Christ. Won't you do that right now? Well, this has been Pastor Billy Crone of Sunrise Baptist Church and Get a Life Ministries. And if there's anything that we can do for you, please don't hesitate to contact us. Our number, our information will come up here on the screen shortly. And if there's anything we could do for you, please don't hesitate to let us know. Thank you for joining us. And remember, I hope to see you in heaven. God bless.
Thank you for watching this presentation from Sunrise Baptist Church. If you would like to send us a letter or any other kind of postage, you can reach us at 1780 Betty Lane, Las Vegas, Nevada, 89156. For more information, you can give us a call at 702-452-8599 or email us at bcrone@getalifemedia.com, or you can visit our website at www.getalifemedia.com. Billy Crone and this ministry can also be found on Facebook and Twitter. Join us for services at www.sunriselv.com.